Okay, so I'll start. So first, thanks for the invitation. I'll try to look at the chat, but I might miss questions if you ask them in chat. So then don't hesitate to interrupt me. I'll try to check questions, but sometimes I miss them when teaching or speaking remotely. So the aim of the talk is to be really introductory. So please don't hesitate to ask questions. Stop me if I'm unclear or if I'm going too fast. It's hard, I think, to have a correct rhythm when only speaking to a screen. So don't. So you can stop me at any time. So the talk is about some area that came up in the late 80s, and that is trying to think about. And then I should maybe click in the right place so that I can move my screen. Okay. So when you do math, I mean, one thing that comes up very frequently is you introduce some class of objects, and then you want to understand how complicated the class is. How you can classify them, typically classify them up to isomorphism, but it could be up to some other notion of equivalence that you have in mind, right? So do you do this with groups? Groups, typically you only think of them up to isomorphism, but they might be topological groups. So you think of them up to isomorphism of topological groups, and then you want to find invariants. One possibility, maybe the taxonomy aspect of mathematics, is to try to put things in little boxes and sort them and understand how whether your notion is complicated or not. So, for instance, maybe the first time in undergraduate math where you meet this is when you classify vector spaces of finite dimension over some fixed field. You say, well, up to isomorphism, they are the same if and only if the dimensions are equal. Then maybe you have numbers, but then they can get more complicated. For instance, for vector spaces, you could have infinite dimensions. You could have different, of course, cardinalities coming up. And sometimes it's mo much more complicated even to classify objects up to isomorphism. And then, so you have plenty of examples, classifications of finitely generated abelian groups. So many such things come up even in undergraduate math. And then there is a second thing that comes up, which is you have a classification and you would like to know whether you can find something simpler or if it is in some sense the best possible. So what I would like to introduce is one way to define first what kind of classifications we will look at. And there are many possible choices. We will only talk about Borel classification, but there are many other natural things to look at, and then try to say in what sense we can decide if a classification is simple or if we could simplify it or not. So first, what's a naive attempt at what a classification is? So X here is a set. You have an equivalence relation, and well, a classification is if you take an element of your set, you assign to it an invariant. An element of I in such a way that, well, two things in X are equivalent if and only if you assign to them the same invariant. This is exactly what I was doing for vector fields. I said, you take a vector field over the reals. Okay, maybe then X is there, not even a set, it's a class, but take a vector field over the reals and then you assign to it the dimension and then you've completely described the vector field. If this is what I call a classification, then we are done, right? Because you could always say, you can always mod out. You can form the quotient of X via E, and then F of X is the equivalence class of X, right? This is a classification, and of course, something that we introduce quite frequently. But this, I don't think this is what we had in mind when we were saying that we wanted to classify objects up to isomorphism. We didn't want to say, look, I mod out by isomorphism and this is my classification. So we would like to do something more explicit. So we would like to have the invariance be concrete, which is a very loose word that has no definite meaning. So I will use definable, but again, this has no. There are very there are many possible ways that you can say that something is definable, but you would like the set of invariants to be definable, to be nice, to be the reals, the integers, or whatever. And you would like the map computing the invariants to be also definable, right, to be nice. This is not a well formulated question because definability depends on the context we're working with. First, it depends on how the class of objects we are working with is given to us, right? So it could be recursively enumerated, it could be just a set, it could be elements of some very nice, it could be reals, I mean. And so the notion of definability that one works with depends on the context. Here, the theory of Borel classification, that is, or Borel complexity, which is the topic of today's talk, is in large part concerned with working with classes of countable objects, and that we want to understand up to some notion of equivalence, but you can think of understand them as up to isomorphism. So countable groups or countable finitely generated groups, why not countable abelian groups, fields, graphs. And then what is definable? What is the correct notion of definability in this context? So typically these classes are uncountable, right? You have uncountably many groups, countable groups up to isomorphism. And there are, when you work with countable objects and you try to, and you look at the kind of classifications that come up in the literature, there is a natural notion of definability, which is, well, I was having fun with my slides, which is that definable is a Borel map, and I have to define what Borel means. But this is our choice of definability notion. We could do, or people could do something completely different if you were working with, say, finite graphs or groups and trying to understand isomorphism of these objects. Then definability would be in terms of calculability, complexity of algorithms, and these kind of things, right? Then this is there are parallels with Borel complexity theory, but it's completely different area. Maybe you would like to say that definable is, I don't know, continuous, recursive, primitive, measurable. It would lead to theories. Okay. So far, all I've said is, we have a notion of definability, and we want to be able to classify, to say that we can present some countable objects, say countable groups, as being belonging to a nice set, which today will be a Borel set, and we'll try to understand classification also in terms of these Borel mappings. So first, I have to explain what a Borel map is. So before that, you have Polish spaces. So we won't need any topology in this talk, but you have spaces which have a countable dense subset, which are metrizable and which admit a complete metric. So you can have in mind that it's the real line is the typical example, the Cantor set, or the bare space product of countably many copies of the integers. But think of R to the D, it's nice topological space, metric space. And then Borel sets, this is what comes up when you take your first class in measure theory. It's the smallest sigma algebra of a Polish space, which contains the open sets, right? So this is what a Borel set is. You have a Polish space, and you take the sigma algebra, smallest one that contains the open sets. Why is this a canonical object? Well, a standard Borel space, so you had this Polish space, there are many of them, and you only kept the Borel sets. So what you have is a sigma algebra on a space. And the point is that if you do this kind of thing on any uncountable space, you will get the same object. So the real line R and R squared, there is a Borel bijection between the Borel isomorphism between them. Cantor space, again, there is a Borel bijection between this and the real and the reals. So all these topological differences at the Borel level, they are completely erased. There is only one such structure. Okay. And there is an issue with this, which actually was the reason why descriptive set theory was born, is that if you take a continuous image of a nice space, you get something that is typically more complicated. So these things are called analytic, continuous images of Polish spaces, or Borel images of Polish spaces. So you go out of the Borel category when you take images. And this was a famous error of Lebesgue at the beginning of the 20th century that really caused the invention of descriptive set theory a little while afterwards. So you have these Borel sets, they are nice objects. If you quantify, if you allow projections, then you go out of this category, which creates complications. And we will only use one such quantifier today, but if you do set theory, then naturally you go much higher up the hierarchy. Okay. So what is a Borel map now? Well, this is again the definition that you've probably all seen when you were taking measure theory classes. This is the inverse image of a Borel set is Borel. Right? You have two sigma algebras, and this is measurability for this for the Borel sigma algebras. A famous theorem due to Lusin and Suslin is that a function is Borel between standard Borel space or between Polish spaces if and only if its graph is itself a Borel set. So this is a really nice, important result, which we will not really need, but which is in the background of what I will talk about later. And why do we use Borel maps as our notion of definability? Is because it's much more flexible than continuous maps. If you take a pointwise limit, if you take a pointwise limit of a sequence of Borel maps, then it's again Borel. This is very badly not true for continuous maps, as you know. So if you take an infimum of a countable family of Borel maps, again, it is Borel. If you have a Borel bijection between two standard Borel spaces, its inverse is automatically Borel, right? Which again is very badly not true for continuous maps. So essentially, if you start from continuous maps and then you want the smallest kind of sigma algebra that gives you this flexibility, then you end up working with Borel maps. So this is what happens if you start from continuous maps and you allow countable conjunctions, disjunctions, and quantifications over sequences. Okay. So then I'll just stop for a few seconds so that everyone catches their breath. So that's what Borel maps are. Now we care about equivalence relations. Well, I said many come up as an orbit equivalence relation. Of course, if you want any equivalence relations appears as an equivalence relation induced by a group action. And groups that will play a minor part in the talk are Polish groups, which are nice groups, topological groups. Group operations are continuous, and the topology is Polish. The only examples that you need to care about are countable discrete groups and the permutation group of all the integers, all bijections of the integers, which has a natural Polish group structure. So these are the groups that will come up. Okay. Now I can get into the Borel classification theory. No questions so far. So let's keep going. So if we backtrack a little bit, we wanted to look at a class of mathematical structures, say countable groups, graphs, or this kind of objects. And for my theory to make sense, this class has to be encoded inside some standard Borel space so that I can look at functions, Borel functions on them. So let me give examples. So graph, here a graph will just be a symmetric and irreflexive binary relation. Okay, this is one possible notion of graph. So if, an infinite countable graph, I can think that its underlying set is just the natural integers. And then it's encoded just by the binary relation, which is symmetric, which is the first axiom that is on the slide there. And I said that my graphs had no loops, so irreflexive. If you look at this comes up as intersections of closed conditions on the product space 0, 1 to the n times n. So the graphs with universe n, they are a closed subset of a Cantor space. And as such, graphs form a standard Borel space. Here, it's important to say that, and I will insist on it again later, that the same graph comes up many times up to isomorphism, right? And there is a choice of coding that I have made. There are other possible choices. But one way to think of all graphs is thinking of them as some binary relations on the integers. You could also take a universal graph and look at all subgraphs of this thing. This would be another coding. Another example that will be the main thread of today's talk is, again, if I think of an infinite countable group as having as its underlying set the integers, then the group is just its multiplication table, which is a ternary function from n to 0, 1, right? Alpha of n, m, p is equal to 1 really should mean n times m is equal to p. That's what I'm coding by this in this set. So then what are the group axioms? Well, you all know them. First, well, this is a multiplication. So there is, for any n and m, there is only one result, which is n times m is equal to p, which I write alpha of n and m. Then there is a neutral element. The operation is associative. There exists an inverse. And I think I wrote down all the axioms of group, hopefully. The point is that, again, this comes up. So something equal to something else is a closed condition in my Cantor space. And I only wrote quantifications of countable sets, right? So I only wrote countable intersections and unions. So again, this is a Borel subspace of a nice Cantor space. I don't worry about the complexity of the definitions in this talk. And if you think of group isomorphism, which we will see later, if we think of group as being encoded in this way, once I fix the universe to be n, the groups are isomorphic if and only if there is a bijection, which is an element of S infinity with my notations. There is a bijection of the integers that takes one multiplication table on to the other, right? So in that coding, group isomorphism is just induced by an action of permutations of the integers. Okay, so these are examples. Of course, you can encode many things in many different ways. And there is something unsatisfying to this whole theory, which is that we have no notion of what a correct coding is or why coding would be better than others. And in particular, it is conceivable that if you encode things using a different coding, that the complexity of the classification problem, which I will introduce on the next slide, could change. So let me give a concrete example. A countable group, if you want to encode it, you could also say, well, I'm fixing F is the free group on countably many generators. And the countable group, well, it is an image of this, of course. And then it means that if I let N of F denote all normal subgroups of the free group on countably many generators, then for any N element of N of F, I have one countable group, which is the quotient. So you could as well use this N of F, this set of normal subgroups, as a way to encode all Borel groups, all countable groups. And if we wanted to encode all, say, countable two generated groups, we would do the same thing with F2 instead of free group on countably many generators. So this is a different coding. You can check in this example that you can move from one coding to the next, to the other, using a Borel map, a Borel bijection, right? So they are essentially equivalent. But it does not mean that there do not exist other codings. So for natural notions, you come up with codings that are equivalent, but this could have an influence, at least in theory. And this is something that we don't have a correct way of addressing this issue. Something that I pointed out already, which is that in any of those codings, the same group up to isomorphism comes up many times. You will have many normal subgroups of the free group on countably many generators, which have the isomorphic quotients, right? So if we want to think of them groups as only up to isomorphism, I've repeated the same isomorphism class many times. This is not a flaw in those codings. This is just a fundamental issue, which is that we want the coding space to be nice, and the isomorphism relation itself is expected to be complex. So you cannot have a nice structure on the quotient space, which is the main issue in this. You cannot have a nice computable nice structure on the quotient space. Okay, so now let's revisit our notion of classification. This is what we had earlier, right? Classification was a set and a function that took elements to invariants, so that two things were equivalent if and only if they were assigned the same invariant. Well, now we know what a Borel classification is. X has to be a standard Borel space. I should have included it in my slide. E is any equivalence relation on X, but I'm asking that the map F and the invariants are both Borel. And if we have a Borel classification, then the usual terminology is to say that E is smooth or concretely classifiable. So in this sense, concrete is Borel. So there is a version of this slide where this is called Church's thesis for real mathematics, but which is a joke by Simon Thomas, but I removed it for this slide. The problem is that, and I will give an example on the next slide, is that many relations that you care about, even very simple ones, are not smooth. They do not admit a Borel classification, right? And then it's hard to say precisely what the complexity of a classification is, just like it's not always easy to define what a cardinality is, unless you have the axiom of choice. But you can still compare complexity. So same here, there is a very strong parallel with cardinalities. You could think of this Borel classification theory as a definable notion of cardinality of quotient spaces. So we can compare complexities. We do not need to know what a cardinal is to say that a set is smaller than another one. It is, there is an injection from X to Y. I don't need to be able to say what a cardinal is to define this. Similarly, here, for equivalence relations, and this is the final, the fundamental definition for this subject, you can say when an equivalence relation is simpler than the other in this setup, which is that E is reducible to F in a Borel way, E Borel reduces to F, it means that you can map the underlying set X of E to the underlying set Y of F in such a way that if you're able to decide whether elements are F equivalent, then you can compose with phi and decide that elements are E equivalent. So what this means is, if you know how to classify F, for instance, then you also know how to classify E just by composing with phi. But more generally, this tells us that F is more complicated because any nice classification, anything that I can do for F, I can do to E by just composing with phi, which I think of as a nice map because Borel maps are the simple objects in my theory, okay? So really this means that the quotient X mod E is simpler than the quotient Y mod F as with by a definable map from X to Y. Right, this is what we have here. And we do not go to quotient structures because they get very ugly. Let me give an example. So first, in this terminology, if for F you take equality and for Y the real line, then what I wrote was X is equivalent to Y if and only if phi of X is equal to phi of Y. This was my definition of being smooth here. So smooth means simpler than equality on the reals. Now, our first example of a non-smooth equivalence relation. On infinite sequences of 0 and 1, you say that they are equivalent if they agree after some n, right? So E0 is my two sequences eventually coincide. This is not a very complicated equivalence relation, but it's essentially the same thing as something that you've seen if you've taken a measure theory class, which is the difference of two elements is a rush of two reals is a rational number. Here the rationals, here there is a group acting 0, 1 to the n is a group. If you add this is z mod 2z to the n, and the group action is just finitely supported sequences. This is relation induced by the group of finitely supported sequences, which is essentially this the group that plays the part of the rationals here. So here again, this is an equivalence relation of the form x is equivalent to y if and only if x minus y belongs to this group of finitely supported sequences. And this is the same, it's not very complicated to see, as the equivalence relations, the equivalence relation that you've already seen, I think, which is the difference of two reals is a rational number. The argument that you've probably seen in measure theory that says that you cannot, how do you build your first non-measurable set in measure theory? You choose an element from each class, and you prove that this will not be measurable. Here, the same argument, actually simpler here in this setup, proves that if you cannot form a transversal, you cannot take something that meets each class in just one singleton and is a Borel set, which in turn is the same as saying that the relation is not smooth. So you've already met non-smooth equivalence relations. And this relation E0 appears in many different guises in mathematics. So let's see an example which goes back to the 1930s, I think. So I want to classify a class of countable abelian groups. So rank one means there are subgroups of the rationals here, subgroup of Q with addition. I should have specified the law, subgroup of Q plus. So this is work of Baer from the 1930s. You fix a prime P and an element of your group, and you define the P type of A. You count how many times A is divisible by P. And this is the P type, okay? So maybe it's infinity. Maybe you can divide by Pn for any n, that's fine. Otherwise, this is just the largest n such that A is divisible by P to the n. Then the type of an element A is just this sequence of all P types over prime P. So you take any element of your group and you look at this sequence Tp of A. So P is 2, 3, 5, and so on. Now this is an infinite sequence. And you define an equivalence relation on those types, which is that they coincide on all but finitely many coordinates. So they eventually agree. And wherever they are different, one is finite if and only if the other is finite. Okay? So another way to say this is you replace n here by 0. Any integer is given the value 0, infinity by 1, and you just remember finite or infinite, and you see something that looks like E0. It's actually stronger than E0 because you want the values to be exactly equal after a while. The theorem of Baer says that if you take any two elements except for the identity, they have the same types. They have equivalent types, sorry, not the same, but equivalent types. So after a while, the sequences are equivalent. And this defines the type of your group. When you take any non-identity element and you call type of G the type, the sequence that's assigned to this. Okay, so you want to understand your subgroups of Q plus up to isomorphism. And you have an obvious thing that if groups are isomorphic, then they will be assigned the same type, right? And theorem of Baer, I think published in 1934. Here, there is a off rank one missing on my slide, sorry. This is, as written, it's completely false. Two torsion free abelian groups of rank one, as in the title of the slide, are isomorphic if and only if they have the same type. Two subgroups of Q plus are isomorphic if and only if they have the same type. Okay, so your invariant in that case is this sequence, and the relation, it's not really hard to see that it's at the same complexity level as E0. You have a Borel reduction from this relation to E0 and the other way around. So this is a setting where, well, the relation that you obtain is not smooth, and then you would like to know, well, can I improve this classification of Baer? Well, we will see that you cannot do this, at least not using this setup, because E0 is the simplest non-smooth equivalence relation that you can get to in this setting. So given that your relation here is as complicated as E0, if you could do something simpler, you could do it to E0, and that is not possible. So this is the best possible classification that you can get for countable abelian groups of rank 1. And then there were attempts of to find classification for subgroup of Q square, Q to the 3, Q to the n for any n. And you would like to know if you can have something which looks like Baer's classification. This has been, I think there were people working on it for a long time. And we will see that complexities of these classification problems actually go up. This is a nice theorem of Simon Thomas. Okay, so this was one example in nature where you encounter E0 when you try to classify mathematical objects. Now, this is not fundamental for the talk, but it will come up. I will try to give an idea of various levels of complexities. So if you have a Polish group, well, you say a nice action of a Polish group is a Borel action. The nicest equivalence relation that we can think of are those that are Borel as a subset of X square. And an issue is that equivalence relation, even induced by nice Polish groups, they do not need to be Borel. They will be analytic, but in general not Borel. Okay, so these are the equivalence relations that we will encounter. An example that I've already mentioned, if you look at isomorphism between countable groups, and you think of countable groups as multiplication tables on the integers, then this comes up as being induced by an action of S infinity, which is a Borel action of a Polish group, even a continuous action of a Polish group on a compact space, on a Polish space in that case. And then the relation is analytic and non-Borel, which is not obvious, and I will mention later. Okay. So now I will give examples. I've reused all pictures of mine, so the picture will move a little bit on the slides because I was too lazy to remake all of this nicely. So what complexity levels do we have? First, I should wait to see if we have questions. No. So we'll see what relations that you've met, probably, where they come up on this complexity levels. Well, first, you have equality on, I guess, the empty set, which is not not very interesting. But then you have equality, you have equivalence relation with finitely many classes, which are all Borel. I mean, equality on a finite set, okay. This is not a very interesting equivalence relation. Then you have equality on the integers, and then you have equality on the real lines, and they get each reduces to the next. So this is not super interesting. But so when you try to reduce a relation here to equality, what you're really doing is trying to count how many classes it has. And in a Borel way, if you impose Borel reduction. So a theorem of Silver, fundamental theorem, is that if you look at a Borel equivalence relation, then there is a jump. Either this equivalence relation is very simple, it's Borel below equality on the natural numbers, which means that you have a countable partitions, you have countably many equivalence classes, each of them Borel, and the relation is very simple. Or the relation is more complicated than equality on the reals. And this is in a Borel way. In particular, if you have a Borel equivalence relation, if it has strictly more than countably many classes, then it has continuum many classes. So you have a continuum hypothesis for this for these objects. And this is even true for coanalytic equivalence relations, which are coanalytic in the complement of an analytic set. And it's very much not true, unless you believe in strong versions of the continuum hypothesis, for analytic. Okay. So this is our first jump between equality on the natural numbers and equality on the reals. There is nothing if we only care about Borel equivalence relations. Then there is the next jump, which is a theorem from Harrington, Kekris, and Louveau. If you have a Borel equivalence relation, then there is nothing in between reals and E0, which is what came up in this when we are looking at classification of countable abelian groups of rank one. So it's not smooth. It's exactly at this E0 level. There is nothing in between. So this is again a nice jump. So this is good, but essentially these are the only examples of such situations that we have. The picture above is very messy. It could very well happen that two equivalence relations that you care about are not Borel reducible to each other. Right? This is very much a partial order with huge incomparability chains. Okay, so this is not, you cannot hope to have this kind of dichotomies. I mean, maybe there are others. Hopefully there are others to be found, but there are not plenty to be sure. But that's what we get at the beginning. We get equality on the integers, then equality on the reals, then E0. And then, well, what's the first level that we have here? It's equivalence relations where all of their classes are at most countable. These things are, I thought this was on my slide, maybe it will come up later. These things are just Borel actions of discrete countable groups. The equivalence relation that arises from Borel actions of discrete countable groups. There exists a universal countable such equivalence relation, which is this red dot, and we will see a concrete incarnation of this soon. So there is something at this level that is more complicated than all such equivalence relations. And the example, due to Simon Thomas and Boban Veličković, is I tried to put things using groups because this was what I used earlier. Isomorphism relation on finitely generated countable groups using any natural coding that you can think of. It sits at this particular level of the hierarchy. In particular, it's already very complicated. It is Borel, but it is much, much more complicated than E0. Okay, so this is already a complicated thing to classify. If you want to produce invariants for finitely generated countable groups, well, you will get something ugly, which of course you knew. Nobody would try to classify this thing and hope to have nice invariants. But this tells you how bad it is. Next level up is whenever you take a Polish group, you get a new universal relation for those that come from a Borel action of G. So for countable groups, this is just G acting on subsets. Why did I say? Yeah, on counter space 2 to the n to the G. For groups, and this is in the original paper of Friedman and Stanley, so isomorphism between countable groups, we've already seen that it came up as an action induced, as an equivalence relation, sorry, induced by an action of S infinity. So it has to be below that. And it's actually exactly at this level. So groups is the most complicated, countable groups is the most complicated equivalence relation you can have for equivalence relations induced by an action of S infinity. It would be the same for countable graphs, for instance, or really something that comes up very often is for whenever you look at a natural classification problem, you get an upper bound, and very often the complexity is exactly this upper bound, which is a bit sad, but that's how it is. Not always. Oh yeah, and then I decided to mention the result of my graduate student, Simon Robert, using topological dynamics, which is if you look at isomorphism of all countable locally finite simple groups, sorry, there should be the word countable here. So countable, locally finite, simple, it's already just as complicated as all countable groups, which is not very good news. It tells you that this notion of complexity does not see many things. So this is perhaps interesting. Of course, classifying finite simple groups was a huge huge work, and this is a huge part in trying to classify finite groups. And there you see that even in the infinite case, locally finite simple groups are already extremely complicated. Next level up, and I will not spend much time on this because I'm getting closer to the end of the talk, you get universal relation for relations induced by a Polish group action. And here, the class of Borel equivalence relation is somewhere here, somewhat transversal here, and there is no universal Borel equivalence relation. And the worst that we will even consider today is the universal analytic equivalence relation, which is a very, very badly complicated equivalence relation. And again, these are strictly more complicated at each level. I want to zoom in, so this I will skip. I want to zoom in on this class of countable equivalence relations and spend 5 minutes on this because I think it's nice. So a theorem of Feldman-Moore that I already mentioned, if you have a Borel equivalence relation with only countable classes, it is induced by a Borel action of a countable discrete group. So these are the actions, these are the equivalence relations that you see exactly when you look at actions of countable discrete groups. And I wanted to mention some open problems at the end of the talk. So this level here, being below E0, among those particular relations, same as being induced by a Borel action of zero. And that is also the same as being an increasing union of relations, Borel, with only finite classes, hence the word hyperfinite here. If a group has all of its equivalence relations hyperfinite, then it is amenable. I think this is Jackson K. Chrislevoy, I forgot to look it up. And here you have some work on this. What do we know about countable discrete groups such that all actions induce an hyperfinite equivalence relation? You have Zn, this is due to Benji Weiss. Then you have finitely generated groups of polynomial growth, which then are virtually nilpotent by Gromov's theorem. So this is Jackson K. Chrislevoy in 2002. Then abelian groups, which is Gao and Jackson. We have all nilpotent groups. The important part here is that the finite generation assumption has disappeared. Even they have locally nilpotent. This is due to Brandon Seward and Scott Schneider in 2015. And I think the paper is not published yet. So probably someone has a hard time referring it. I don't know what the story is, but it's been a preprint as far as I know since 2015, which is a long time. And it's an open problem for amenable groups. So there is a nice area in geometric group theory, which is trying to say things about groups based on the equivalence relations that they induce. It's very well developed in the measured theoretic setting. So this is measured group theory, where you look at measured orbit equivalence. And here for Borel orbit equivalence, we don't really, it's not as well understood. So the open problem I mentioned here is, take a Borel action of a countable amenable group. Is it true that the equivalence relation is hyperfinite? And we are fairly far from this, right? We are only at nilpotent, and these are all these three papers are complicated, difficult work each time. And now for our classes of groups. We mentioned before isomorphism between torsion-free abelian groups of rank less than n, that is subgroups of Q to the n. So this is essentially countable because this is induced by an action of GLNQ. two subgroups are isomorphic if and only if there is an element of GLNQ that maps one to the next and GLNQ is countable. So what do you have? Beautiful result of Simon Thomas is that for any n, these relations get the relation up to rank n plus 1 is strictly more complicated than the relation for rank n. So this is, I think, interesting because there was work for trying to find invariants as Baer's invariants for groups of rank 1, but this is telling you that that is impossible because those invariants were giving you E0 and the relations that you get are strictly above E0. So you cannot hope to have such a thing. The relations are strictly growing in complexity. And Simon Thomas also proved in the same paper that isomorphism group of on all abelian groups of finite tabs, so groups that are subgroups of Q to the n for some n, this is not universal. So this is below, strictly below E infinity. So you get a nice example of a strictly increasing chain here. Okay, I think I'm getting close to the end of my talk. Yeah, so an open problem here is what is the complexity of the relation isomorphism for finitely generated amenable groups? Finitely generated groups is here. It's at the top, it's E infinity. What is finitely generated amenable groups? I guess the expectation is that it is also universal for equivalence relations with countably many classes. But I think all that we know for sure is that it is above E0. So it's somewhere in there and we don't know where, which is not very good. And it's expected that an answer will come from topological dynamics, I think, but I will not go into this today. I think this is my last slide, or next to last slide. An open problem that's perhaps as old as model theory. I will frame it in model theoretic terms if you've seen this before. You look at a first order complete theory and you wonder how many models, how many countable models it has up to isomorphism. And in particular, you would like to know whether this number is always either countable or uncountable or continuum. So, continuum hypothesis for these objects. This is open. And Borel actions of S infinity, they are more general than, so this is the topological Vogt conjecture, this is Vogt conjecture, sorry. So this is essentially the same thing as asking, take your favorite complete first order theory, is it true that it has either countably many models up to isomorphism or continuum many? It's known that the number is either Aleph 0, Aleph 1, or continuum, meaning that if you believe in the continuum hypothesis anyway, this question is stupid because, well, of course, if it's strictly bigger than countable, it is continuum. But you could have maybe the word variant these days is not very well chosen, but there is a definable version of this, so the topological Vogt conjecture, which is look at a relation which comes from a Borel action of a Polish group. Is it true that either it is below equality on the natural numbers or it sits above equality on the reals? And in particular, it will have either countably many classes or continuum many classes, but in a definable way. So this is, I think, the main open problem in this field. And I think this was my last slide. So thank you for watching.